Woe to you, O earth and sea, for the devil sends the beast with wrath, because he knows the time is short. Let him who have understanding reckon the number of the beast, for it is a human number. Its number is 666.
I left alone. My mind was blank. I needed time to think, to get the memories from my mind. What did I see? Can I believe that what I saw that night was real and not just fantasy? Just what I saw in my old dreams, were they reflected of my world man staring back at me? 'Cause in my dreams, it's always there, the evil face that twists my mind and brings me to despair. All this for real, or just some kind of hell? 666, the number of the beast. Hell and fire was born to be released.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the very depths of hell,
Golan-Globus Theater.
All right, we got a fucking big shout out to our boy Pro Satanis for hooking us up with that intro there, and of course
the great Anton Maiden.
Anton Maiden.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know what rock you've been living under if you've never heard of Anton Maiden. I'm assuming if you listen to our podcast, you know who the great Anton Maiden is. Of course, he improved every Iron Maiden song, and sadly, he's no longer with us.
He's gone?
Yeah, he killed himself.
No, we didn't.
No, he did. He really did kill himself.
Oh, goddamn.
But I tried to look at it on the positive. You know, like, you know, they say when Alexander the Great conquered all the civilized world, he wept because there's no more world to conquer.
Sure, sure.
I think Anton, once he perfected every Iron Maiden song, he was like, why I'm here is done. It's time to move on to the next journey in life.
Yeah.
And he killed himself.
Oh, no.
Big ups to Anton Maiden. We love you. R.I.P., buddy.
Oh, my God. If only he was in a Golan-Globus movie, we could talk about him all day. But unfortunately, we have to live through the art he did leave us. But anyways, we got to get on to smaller, less interesting topics.
In a way, I guess. I mean
Anton's a star.
Chuck.
What does Chuck have?
He's a star of our show. I mean, you and I aren't on the bandwagon, but everyone else is, and we appreciate it. But yeah, he has a siren called like song he weaves on people, but it's deaf to us.
It really is, and I was excited to find out that this movie was directed by Chuck's own stunt double of a brother, Aaron Norris.
Have we learned through the show that Aaron Norris directed in practically every Chuck Norris movie?
Oh, no. I looked it up, and he's only directed, like, two of the movies that we would cover.
Okay.
We're definitely not doing Top Dog. He directed that fucking pile of shit. I tried to watch that movie a while ago, and I was like, oh!
The one where he's got a cop dog partner?
Yeah, yeah.
What was that one? The 90s were a weird decade, because there was, like, two other cop dog movies.
Yeah.
There was a Tom Hanks one, Turner Hooch,
and then
Jim Belushi. Yeah, I don't remember what that one was.
Dog cops, man. Everybody.
Well, then there was also it wasn't a dog, but there was Cop and a Half, where Burt Reynolds and a little black kid were cop.
Yeah,
partners.
I remember that one. Yeah.
Yeah, there was a lot of weird law enforcement shit going on in the 90s. There was a very lax rules.
Trying to ease kids into the cop world or something. I don't know.
You can trust a cop kind of thing.
All I know is if
we're saw that dog, first of all, beating somebody with a nightstick.
Of course he did. Abuse of power.
Right.
Did he I'd like to see the scene where he gets chewed out by his superior.
Literally chewed out.
Give me your leash and your badge. Your collar and badge. I guess that's what it would be.
Yeah. That sounds all even more exciting than the movie we were going to talk about.
Oh, yeah. I mean...
I'm kidding. It's great. This movie's great.
It is fun. A lot more fun than fucking Against the Dark. But what I'm really hoping to figure out is, can Aaron Norris get the best out of his brother? And I think the answer we can just spoil for you now is no, he can't.
Yeah, I mean, before we get into like the movies, we were under the impression... Because it's still Schlocktober still going on. So we were on the impression that this was going to be, and judging by the trailer, we thought this was going to be a horror movie. And it is, in a way, quasi-horror. But there's a shitload. I mean a shitload. And we've gone on record in our other Chuck episodes. Chuck could not deliver a one-liner if he had a gun in his head.
No.
And there's tons of comedy in this fucking movie.
Tons. Like... Last week, we thought we dodged a bullet because Mike was telling us that Howling 2 was originally shot as a comedy.
Right.
And then the guy was like, no, fuck that. Horror. U-turn. This movie didn't get that U-turn.
Well, maybe it was. Maybe it was a horror movie. And then Aaron was like, I know my brother can make him laugh. I'm going to change this. Because, of course, this movie was a victim of the Lethal Weaponitis. Because, first of all, Lethal Weapon's a great fucking movie.
Yeah.
But it set the standard for white cop, black cop, a lot of hijinks back and forth. So that's what we have a lot of that in this movie. And let's put it this way. They're no Danny Glover or Mel Gibson.
No, not by a long shot. Also, Mel Gibson's hair is a lot better.
I mean, he had a way better mullet than what Chuck's rocking.
Shit. You may have noticed a couple familiar faces. Chuck Norris is co-starring, kind of. She's barely in the movie, but that's his love interest in Walker, Texas Ranger.
What?
Which also started the same time this movie came out. So I think this was just a platform for, like, Walker, Texas Ranger.
Didn't get the job being in this movie. I've never watched, well, except for that episode I talked about on our first episode, I've never watched Walker, Texas Ranger.
Yeah.
So I did not know that.
Yeah. So she's in that. And then, man, I mean, what would you rate her out of 10?
Fuck, she was a 12, bro.
I didn't know what you meant by that earlier. And then I rewatched it this afternoon. I was like, oh, fuck.
Yeah, she's a 12. You know, before we get in the movie, Griff, I just want to ask you a question, because you just got back from the mecca of hipsterdom, Williamsburg, Brooklyn.
Yeah, okay.
How long were you there?
I was there for 4 days.
Are there any trends I'm going to be annoyed with in the next 6 months that, you know, you should fill me in on?
Velcro shoes.
Really? It kind of makes me steaming right now.
Yeah, you're probably excited about that. I've seen you try to bend over to tie your shoes. You get out the...
It's getting harder as I get older. Yeah,
come on, man. You can't fall apart.
But
yet.
I'm doing it because it's practical. I'm not doing it for a fashion sense.
Yeah, I understand that. That's
so
good.
Velcro shoes.
Antique hands. I kept walking by
antique
street
hands.
Vendors that were selling like dummy hands. I shit you not. 15 different people were selling just like little plastic hands.
Interesting.
I don't know what that was all about. I don't know how that is near fashion. But
were they like painted weird colors, or was it just a mannequin hand?
Just the mannequin hand. That's it. Always white, though. I didn't see any.
That's not very progressive.
No, it
isn't. I thought that was what Brooklyn was about.
What else? Oh, shit. I don't know. I think you're seeing it around here now. It's just higher pants.
Yeah,
like pants
I've seen that.
Yeah. A lot of that. That's about it. We're pretty much on par with them for the most part.
Oh,
like
really?
They're not doing anything too crazy.
Really? You're slacking, Brooklyn.
Yeah, they really are. They're not trying hard enough anymore.
Well, I spent the other day in beautiful Frankenmuth, Michigan.
Oh, did you? My family was out there this weekend.
Really?
Yeah.
What day?
Saturday.
And I was there Monday.
Ah.
good, because I would slap your brother. But
Jesus.
But But and for anyone who's like outside of Michigan doesn't know what we're talking about. Frankenmuth's this lovely Bavarian village right smack dab in the middle of Michigan. And
everybody in the world has heard Tim Allen whisper his sweet nothings about Frankenmuth in their ear. So
yeah, so it's just a tourist trap. And I never, if I had been there, it'd been at least 40 years. I have no remembrance of being there. And I had a really shitty chicken meal.
Very good.
Very expensive, very shitty.
The full experience.
Yeah. And one cool thing, we went to that Bronner's place, which is like
the
giant Christmas place. And I got a fucking cool-ass Thor Santa Claus ornament.
There you go.
And I'm talking about real Thor, not Marvel Comics Thor. I'm talking about God of Thunder Thor.
I like the Thor with the big blonde beard.
Well, he's got the beard, yeah. And he's holding like an axe in one hand and the hammer of Thor in the other one.
Oh, it looks, shit, yeah.
It's pretty sweet.
That's pretty dope.
But this is just me padding our episode because I don't think we're going to have much to talk
about. I don't know why we bother padding it. I mean, we're going to go in light, just blazing for what? I'm padding it now, too.
Yeah, let's just get into it, Griff. Let's go to the trailer. This is did we mention this earlier? This is Cannon's last ever movie.
Yeah,
This is a Globus production. Sadly, this is when Golan Globus had their falling out. And they broke off, and they did two separate companies. And I guess Globus stayed with Canon, and then Menachem Golan did his thing. But fortunately, they got back together. They realized we're more powerful together than we are apart. So they did get back together. But this is the last ever Canon film, and we can see why, and you'll learn why as we talk about it. So we're going to go to the trailer, cut the trailer right now. Chuck Norris in Hellbound.
I prepare to anoint my spirit with this royal blood.
Forged in the fires of hell.
So why not? You seek to deny my destiny.
Banished from the sight of man. Now, he has crossed into our world to reclaim his power.
I know what you are, and I know why you are here.
Chuck Norris is Shatter, bound to uncover more than a secret.
Please. The man that was murdered last night on Polanski Street was a rabbi.
There's 8 dead bodies in here.
8
holy men.
Bound to bring back more than a killer.
According to the myth, the scepter was broken into 9 sections.
What kind of man kills like this?
We'll know soon enough.
Bound to face the most terrifying enemy he has ever known.
The scepter is the key to the gates of hell.
Who was it that ripped the heart right out of his chest?
Have you any idea who I am?
Let me introduce myself.
Chuck Norris, Hellbound.
The legend says, when time began, the soul of darkness was thrust into the depths. Its evil split from the light of humanity to be called forth in times of weakness and despair. Satan's emissary, Prasatanos, would prowl the earth, searing all before him with fire and blood.
And then there's some more shit. I'm just repeating this like Star Wars crawl they had at the very beginning of the movie.
Yeah,
we were too bored to write the entire thing.
It was so pointless, and it leads into our Renaissance intro, and it's not just the cold
Middle Ages.
Yeah,
where the year is 1186 AD.
Oh, they mentioned the year?
Yes, they
do. I didn't catch it. 1186, huh? Man.
So we see Richard the Lionhearted and the Crusaders just hauling ass on horses.
Yeah.
They're in Israel.
Yeah. And you seem to want to go, so.
Okay, I will go. So they're looking for something. What are they looking for? Well, they're looking for a tomb. So they go into these catacombs. They find this giant crucifix. And they push it aside because it's a door. And they go in there. And this is where we meet our villain of the movie, Prasatanus, which, of course, is Latin for one who is pro-Satanus.
Oh, yeah.
And
you hear people yelling it down the streets on Devil's Night all over here.
Yeah. And he's not Satan. I learned that. I thought he was. He's an emissary of Satan, though. As we learned in the crawl I read earlier.
Yeah.
And he's trying to bring about the end of the world, the apocalypse. And how does he do that? Well, he has his power scepter, like He-Man's power sword.
Yeah.
And he needs the blood of royalty.
Royal blood.
So we learned that he had Richard Lionheart's son, little baby.
Oh, that's who that was?
Yes.
Oh, man.
And he was just about to kill the baby until Richard Lionheart busted in and said, "You ain't killing my baby, bitch."
Yeah.
And then all hell breaks loose, no pun intended.
No, oh, I see what you did there.
And so these monsters that are like they look like tall Jawas from Star Wars because they're wearing like hoods.
Yeah,
they start fighting the knights and back and forth. It's and
just, yeah, I
and Pro Satanas is just sitting back chilling, doing nothing.
Yeah, it's 13 minutes of when's Chuck gonna show up? Is Chuck gonna like be one of these time travelers who's just always here, eternal battle throughout time? No.
Well, so what happens is they grab the baby, so they can't do the ritual anymore because they need the royal blood sacrifice to bring Satan to Earth. And then this monk like spears Prosatanas in the back with some shit. And then the altar was also a coffin, a sarcophagus.
A sarcophagus.
And so they prod him in, like they got him like on the end of a stick, like a head of a fish or something. They're like prodding him into the sarcophagus, and they get him in there, and they close it. You see the hand reach out. Ooh, scary. They seal the top, and then they get these pretty cool ass looking like daggers with crucifix hilts, and they pierce him in every corner to hold down the lid.
Yeah. To keep the evil powers at bay.
And then Richard the Lionheart goes, "Fuck this noise," and he grabs the scepter that Prosatanas had, and he chops it into nine pieces.
Nine pieces, very
perfectly. Perfect. You notice how they were perfectly like the same size.
I hear he went on to cut perfect cuts of sushi.
He worked at Benihana. Many people don't know this, but Richard the Lionhearted founded Benihana. He did. Yeah. So the Japanese culture appropriated from Richard the Lionhearted.
You should have seen that man behind a hibachi. It's amazing. It's fucking. That was also left on the editing floor.
Yeah, so then he's like, "Then we're going to spread these pieces to the four winds no one can find them and no one can awaken Prosatanas."
This is not the setup for a movie. This is the setup for a video game, like an adventure. This is a Zelda game that they're setting up. So you're like,
well, maybe there was going to be a tie-in at one time.
Maybe there's going to be a Nintendo game. Oh, Super Nintendo. Yep, she's already back with the fucking the loudest squeaker in the house.
She's like, "Don't talk about this movie. You're boring." But we're going to talk about it, Millie.
Fuck you, Mill.
Deal with it.
So now we've got these nine pieces scattered. The tomb's going to be like hidden away.
Cut forward to 1951.
51. And a couple of no good Tomb Raiders are just going to. There was like an inch of dirt.
Speaking of video games, Tomb Raider.
Tomb Raider.
I like that.
All right. See my segue skills?
So, like the Arab male versions of Lara Croft.
Yep. Who they storm into, you know, this old. I think it was supposed to be like a church. They said later in the movie that it was a church, so I'm going to say church.
Yeah, I don't know.
And, you know, they see the crucifix daggers that were holding
and
the.
They're made of gold, so they're like, "Fuck yeah."
They're like, "Look at these gems." And, you know, so they're step pulling it out, and they're like, finally, like, "We got to look in this thing." And so they start to fucking knock that little lid ajar. And I think a hand comes up and pulls his buddy in, and you just get some shrieking. So we get kind of a thrill here. We're getting like, "Oh shit, spooky!"
Right. And then this guy, the other guy, he's like, just totally leaves his friend to die. But he didn't. He never does arm day it when he's working out, so he didn't have the power to pull himself back up.
No.
And so Prosatanas gets out and gets him, kills him, and like, "Oh, okay," that's how he talks when he's Prosatanas.
Yeah,
he talks like this.
He's got
a lot of voice
voices,
effect on it. And then we're like, Now, cut to present day.
Present day.
Because this movie's timeless. They're not going to say 1993 when the movie came out.
Yeah, exactly.
Even though they talk a shitload about the Michael Jordan Bulls in this fucking movie.
Nonstop.
Which also irritated me because you know I'm a hardcore Pistons fan and I hate Michael Jordan.
3-0 start, man. We're going all the way. One thing I did want to mention, the timeline of this with it being 93 and all, with the playoffs going on. Did the playoffs used to be in the fall? Because as far as I know, it's always been in the spring.
Yeah.
And everybody in this movie, when they're in Chicago, which the whole movie was filmed in Israel, they're always wearing coats.
It was a style. They had starter jackets on.
Starter jacket. It would have been great if they were starter jackets. They probably couldn't get the licensing for that. Too expensive. So we're going to show up. We're going to see Chuck and his buddy.
Chuck is crazy.
He's insane. We see Chuck pulling out all of his acting skills here. This is probably the most acting I've ever seen him
do. And this guy's just like a penny ante drug dealer. He's not even a murderer. And Chuck's ready to murder him.
Yeah.
He puts a gun to his head. He's like, I'm going to fucking kill you if you don't tell us where Spider's at.
And this is like pro-level wrestling type choreography. Chuck's getting ready to shoot this guy, and his partner pushes the gun out of the way at the last second.
His partner, Jackson. Of course, he's black, so his name has to be Jackson.
Oh, man.
Well, I'm just saying, that's what they would do.
I know it. The old man is reserved for the team who put this together. I love how they do that. But so he's going to calm Chuck down, and he's like, hey, Frank Shatter's his name.
I told Griff, I thought it was Jack Shatter for like half the movie. I was writing it down in my notes as Jack Shatter, which sounds way cooler. But
I think that's a current movie with John Cusack.
I don't know.
I can't remember his name. Krasinski?
No, that's, I know you're talking about.
Jack Ryan.
Yes.
John Ryan?
I don't know, because it seems like every action hero is named John or Jack something. Yeah. Jack Shatter sounds cooler, by the way.
I want him to be called White Guy, that's action, Liam Neeson. So they're doing this whole good cop, bad cop. We all know it because Chuck doesn't have a bad bone in his body. He doesn't even have a bad beard.
He murders
there.
People with his fists. That's what I know he's not going
to. Yeah. So they're,
can we,
you know,
wait, when we go on, can we talk about Jackson's hair for a minute? What's going on with it?
Well,
he's got like Raggedy Andy hair. Like he's like they're not dreads, they're braids.
I feel like what's his name might have done this hairstyle at one point. Rick James.
No, Rick James had longer though. But I can accept like a long kind of like dreadlock braid thing.
He did.
This was like a bowl cut. It was the worst.
It was chin length.
It was a bob.
But he did the bangs. So he had that nice window square cut bob going on. It was very interesting. Like his personality did not match the hair.
Yeah, so he comes in, he's like, Frank, hold it. Come on, man. He's going to kill you, man.
Yeah.
Just tell me where Spider's at. Or do you tell me who's at?
Yeah. Whisper it in my ear.
Spider. And then he runs away.
Scatters off. And
then I'm like, I'm actually excited because I'm like, wow, Chuck's going to show some range in this. He's like a fucking maniac cop.
Great episode, by the way. Yeah. We're just used to hearing Chuck whisper one-liners and, you know, you don't expect anything.
I'm thinking
out of
he's going to be fucking Martin Riggs from Lethal Weapon. Like he's going to be a nut job.
Yeah.
No.
They turn the corner. They see a pimp slapping a woman around and they're just like, Spider, speak of the devil. So they go to confront him. Chuck notices a little.
Before they do a little, hey, man, you see the game last night? You gonna get those tickets for me?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then Frank's like, yeah, yeah, I'll get you those tickets.
You really want to make sure to build up this relationship, huh?
Exactly. These guys are like brothers.
They're like brothers. Even though like Chuck shits on them all the time. Like he reminds them of the status quo nonstop. Like whenever it's convenient for him. He's like, I'm going to hold the money because, well.
You don't.
Shrugs at him. So limousine pulls up. A couple weird guys get out. You know, Jackson's too busy worrying about the pimp. But
he's beating the shit out of the pimp. So we learn that Jackson's crazy, too, in a way.
Yeah, it was even before that. But
And then Chuck just beats the shit out of a guy for no reason. Like, guy's just standing there who's like a henchman of Spider.
Dude, he was pulling out a gun.
Was he?
Yes.
But I thought, no, I could have swore like so Chuck was getting in his face fucking with him. And he's like, I'll kick your ass, motherfucker.
Okay, because you forgot the scene. I'm gonna take us through it. Nice and slow here. I don't want to do this slowly. So Chuck is busy noticing the people. Jax is over there getting all mixed up and everything. And Chuck conveniently shows up just as the guy, the second henchman, because there was Spider and his henchman. So the henchman was about to pull out a gun, and Chuck shows up and puts a gun into his face. And then he gets in the guy's face, and he's just like, this isn't how tough people do it. You want to show me how tough you are? So he takes the gun. He throws both his gun and the guy's gun away, and he's just like, why don't you go ahead and hit me one? He kept saying that. He didn't say punch me. Why don't you hit me one? And so the guy's like, well, all right. And he punches Chuck in the face.
Right, and Chuck just blows it off like it was nothing.
Chuck shrugs it off, and then he fucking uppercuts him, and the guy moon arcs over a car.
It was like, an uppercut from Punch-Out.
Yeah.
He was flying off his feet.
It was a little foreshadow of exaggerated strength, because we're going to see that a lot with Prosatanos.
Yeah, so they're having some good old fun beating the shit out of some low-level hoods.
They're both
meanwhile,
being bad cop.
Speaking of Prosatanos.
Yeah, what has he been up to in
these
4 years?
Well, he's been fucking
years.
A prostitute. Right now, he's up in his chilling in a hotel room, and it's the most annoying prostitute. The only they say you don't pay for the sex, you pay for him to leave. This perfectly fits in with that thing because she's super annoying. And she's like, I'm gonna take a shower. Do you like showers? And he's like, whatever, I'm gonna get dressed. So, and I don't know why she was in there because she wasn't naked. I don't know what her purpose was in this movie.
Well, Chuck wouldn't allow nudity, so there was more nudity than I expected.
Where was the nudity at?
She wasn't nude. There was more cleavage and skin.
There was
shown.
Insinuation of nudity. Yeah. Because she takes a shower, but you don't see anything.
Like, I think we've seen Chuck in his underwear once, and that's about as much nudity as
Well, he's
probably
all about showing his body.
Well, yeah.
Come on, equal opportunity, Chuck. Come on.
Yeah. He's like a little Wolverine, that man.
So while she's taking a shower, our mysterious characters, one's named Krieger. One's the rabbi. I don't remember his name.
Yeah, I don't remember the rabbi's name. They actually just called him rabbi, so.
And he is going to deliver a piece of the scepter of power that Prosatanos needs because that's the source of his power.
Yeah.
So that's what Prosatanos has been doing for the past 30, 40-odd years. He's been collecting these pieces. So now this is like the head of the scepter. So the Krieger guy, who's like the middleman, he's like, all right. I got my money. See you later. He takes off, leaves the rabbi with Prosatanos.
Mm.
And then Prosatanos is like, give me the scepter. And he's like, fuck you. And he whips out one of those crucifix knives. And he's like, I know who you are, and I'm going to let you have this. And he stabs Prosatanos. Then, of course, he just blows it off. He's like, I'm Prosatanos, motherfucker.
Yeah, he feigns death, and he like falls over on the bed, and then... You know, Rabbi does a whole, like, victory speech, and dude just opens up his eyes. And is this when we first see, like, his weird little eye skin thing he has going on?
When he's Prosatanos, his eyebrows disappear. That's how you can tell it's Prosatanos.
Well, he has, like, weird eye thing going on,
does
too.
He?
Yeah.
He looked like a weird, like early 90s WWF wrestler.
He did. He really did.
He was rocking a skullet. He's, like, super balding, but his long hair.
I wish to promote his own show. They had Kelsey Grammer as Prosatanos.
You're right. It is like a buff Kelsey Grammer.
Yeah, I would have loved Kelsey Grammer. That would have made this movie 95 times better.
Yeah, and now you say, it's weird. He kept talking about tossed salad and scrambled eggs.
All the time. He's just like, I'm about to toss your scrambled eggs. Wow. But yeah, he just pops up Undertaker style where he just launches
right.
The top half of his body up.
He's a total Undertaker.
And he just looks at that man's chest, that rabbi, and he's just like, good try. And then he launches forward.
That's how good the one-liners were. Like, yeah. Chris probably not even exaggerating. He probably just said, good try. Good try.
There you go.
That's his voice.
And he pulls the Indiana Jones move because we've already been ripping off
Kalima! Kalima!
Except he fucking rips this guy's heart out. Right. And so then
he probably says, like, eat your heart out or some horrible line.
Prostitute
like that.
Pops out of the fucking shower and she screams. And he just grabs her and, just like we saw last week, fucking chucks her out of a window. Here's another instance. A body lands on a car. They don't give a shit. Like, that's scary as fuck. That's going to you're gonna get spooked.
Frank Shatter and Jackson have seen this shit before.
I guess. So they don't even have a jump scare. But Chuck's like, we got to get up there.
He's like, Mondays, you know, yeah, like this Mondays. Again.
We're not gonna make it in time for the Bulls game tonight.
And he's like, and then as he says 20 or 50 times, I'm like, oh hell no! So, it's just like, you know, some super fucking out of touch white guy wrote every line for
you
Jackson.
Know, Aaron Norris was like, no,
they're gonna love this.
Get into it, like feel the inner urban. Is that okay to say to you?
Yes.
So. They're going to rush up there. Well, Chuck's going to rush up there. Jackson's going to fucking take his time.
He's still whipping the shit out of Spider.
Yeah, he's giving him a couple more kicks. And Chuck gets up there, and he just gets fucking bombarded by Broach Sotanis. But he's got his gun on him, and he shoots him a couple times in the chest, but it does nothing. I mean, we saw this man take a dagger to the heart, so we know nothing's stopping him. So they engage in some fisticuffs. Pro Satanas is just tossing them all over the room like it's nothing. And I think he just leaves them
like
that.
Yeah, he just leaves.
And finally, fucking Jackson comes
finally
in the room.
Finally shows up. He was checking the Bulls game score.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, fuck. He's probably so used to Frank kicking ass.
Exactly.
He's just like, you don't need me.
He got a little too used to his partner's abilities. So he shows up, and Chuck's just like sitting on the bed, mulling things over, like... Fuck, man.
But you know what I don't understand is if the scepter is the source of power, then how does he have powers?
Yeah, I mean, they explain what the scepter is later. I mean, do we want to talk about it now, or do we want to...
Well, no, they said in the very beginning, it's the source of his power.
And
it also opens the gate to hell or whatever.
Yeah. So maybe it's just as he slowly assembles it, his power gets a little stronger, and then eventually when it all comes together, it's the key.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes more sense.
They didn't really give us much to work with, so they gave us no like rules to how he has powers or anything, just that he has them.
Yes.
And he throws people. So Jackson shows up, and we get one of those beautiful moments where he's like, oh, man, what the hell happened to you? What's going on in here? He's like... I told you I'm not carrying that piece with me anymore. I gave that guy two slugs in the chest. Apparently, Chuck's not a fan of guns.
Well, he's like, he obviously was wearing a vest.
Yeah, that's a bulletproof vest, man. And he's like, yeah, I don't know about that. And he's like, what happened in here? He's like, I don't know, go look at this guy. He's like, oh, what's wrong with him? He's got a hole in his chest. Oh, shit, did someone rip his heart out or something? Yeah, it's over there on the floor. Just nonchalant.
That's how great the humor is.
Yeah.
And they're really shoehorning as much humor in as possible. And I ain't feeling that.
It is Chuck flat as all can be. And then
no
Jackson.
Inflection to his voice
exactly.
at all.
Just like, and Jackson just over the top, all hell knows, all over the place.
I think what happened was the guy who played Jackson was like, holy shit, I have to amp my shit up super high to balance out the super lows of Chuck. So he went full, like, fucking almost minstrel show. It was, like, really bad.
Yeah, it's rough.
So we cut to the scene we always got to see in these Golden Globus movies.
Every time.
The captain chewing out our cops.
Mm.
But there's a twist.
It's not any old captain, is it?
It's a female captain.
Ooh, shit.
And of course, she looks like a school marm. She's got her hair tied in a tight bun.
Yep.
You know, she can't remember last time she had sex. So she's just like, so there's a lot of sexual tension going on right now.
She is really into Chuck. You can see it.
Yeah. Well, that comes into play later on, but we'll get to that later.
Meet me halfway.
And she's just chewing them out. She doesn't call for their gun and badge yet, but she's just like, you get your shit in order. I don't know. What did they do? They were so bad.
I have no idea.
We know nobody cares that they beat the shit out of the spider and those guys.
Yeah.
But
like they're doing a good job. The only thing I could see them maybe getting in trouble for is the hooker that was thrown out of window. And they were just like, she's alive. Let's forget about her. I doubt they even put her in the car. They probably just left her on the hood and drove to the hospital like that.
Or
showed up to work the next day.
So
later.
They just go, yeah, whatever, and they walk out of the office. And unfortunately, forensics did a rush on the job of the fingerprint dusting of the
I do need
piece.
To point out, when she talks to Chuck, and she tells him, like, your ass is on the... She's pointing just directly at his dick.
I might believe it, yeah.
Yeah, that's the level of tension here. So, yeah, the evidence...
She's
expedited.
Actually talking to his dick. That's how it's just like...
Can you lean forward a little bit?
So they go to the forensics, and they're like, hey, because, you know, we know the world we live in, like, we can get DNA tests in, like, an hour, you know. But yeah. they just make, in real world, they just make you wait because they're just assholes.
They're just assholes.
But if they want to get it done, they get it done. They're like, hey, we dusted the scepter piece. Because he got away, Prosatanis got away without the piece.
Yeah, they managed to get the head of the scepter.
Yeah, and they're like, there's two fingerprints on it. We found this rabbi, and then we don't know who the other one is. Which, of course, we know is Prosatanis.
Prosatanis.
And then they go, well, you need to check out some university. Oh, yeah, because he's like, this is like some ancient thing. You need to go to this university. And
yeah, they had the
talk
card.
To an archaeologist. Oh, that's right. There was a card for this, like, Dr. Lockley.
We're always supposed to believe these
Or Professor Lockley.
Professor Lockley, yeah. We're always supposed to believe, like, our detectives or sergeants or whoever we're following are super smart and, like, find things that other people can't find. But it's like every time it's set up on a platter, it's like, we've got so much evidence. They have a card with the man's name on it and another person's name with an address.
Yeah.
So it's like, oh, man, how are we going to figure out the next lead to this case? Let's just read this card a couple times. So.
Well, hey, Griff, we got 90 minutes, so we need to just cut to the chase.
Do we
really want to watch them? Like, really, doing police work?
I want to see them sandwiches, staking out, you know, just bantering back and forth.
So they go to the university where Professor Lockley is a professor, and but he's out of town. So they meet. This is where we meet the love interest, kind of.
Yeah, the love interest is very respectable. It's very Hank Hill, where they just kind of nod at each other. And
well, it's Chuck. Chuck doesn't have sex.
Chuck doesn't have sex.
But he does in a movie we're going to talk about. Probably, I don't know, probably a couple months from now. But
no way.
Yes, he does have sex in it.
Oh,
it's a movie I wish I'd known about, and we would have done this one instead of the one we're doing.
It's actually more of a thriller.
Yeah. So, so we meet Dr. Or Professor Leslie Hawkins. She's the assistant to Professor Lockley, and she's like, oh, he's in Israel at this archaeological dig. Can I help you?
Yeah, let me come down and share a word with you. And as she's coming down, Jackson's like, hey. Out of 10.
And what Chuck's like, she's a 12.
<Just so dead.
laughs> And we also have to point out, he's wearing a Miami Vice. It's like 1993, and he's wearing a Miami Vice outfit, like this blazer with the T-shirt and the baggy pants.
He's all of 5'2", and he's wearing this blazer that basically meets between his knee and his waist. And then he's always got a black shirt tucked in with, like, a shitty woven belt. Like, he's looking shit.
Well, for 1993, I guess he's looking pretty fly. But even then, I mean, it's like, dude, like, Miami Vice was, like, 10 years earlier.
Again, Aaron Norris really knows how to direct his brother.
He's like, yeah, you're a relic of the 80s. We're going to keep you dressed in the 80s.
Exactly.
Because he's wearing this over baggy suit. It looks like fucking David Byrne suit. It's like a super giant baggy suit.
It's damn near Byrne size.
So, of course, there's sexual tension. Because everyone Chuck meets, there's sexual tension that's never consummated. It's the opposite of Steven Seagal.
It is.
Where he fucks everybody.
There is a lot of that just like unparalleled absolute like adoration of the character, but instead of in Seagal's case where everybody just wants to jerk him off, everybody's just like, yeah, I want to be near you, and that's it. They just want to be near him,
just want to hug you.
So
she breaks down the whole story of Prosatanis. She tells us what we learned in the beginning of the movie.
Nine pieces.
It's your Legend of the Zelda quest.
You got to collect the Master Sword, the three pieces of the Triforce.
She's like, this piece you brought me is the top of the scepter, yada, yada, yada.
How did you find this? Well, we pulled it out of a prostitute's butt the other night.
So now we cut to Italy. Bro, this is a globetrotting movie.
Oh, man.
We're on a train. We got two Italian priests.
And
they got it.
That's almost a setup for a joke. Two Italian priests.
It's funnier than anything Chuck says.
Yeah.
And so they got this pimped out like box, velvet line, got jewels all on it. We learned that's got a piece of the scepter in it, and it's the final piece besides the head of the piece that Chuck has.
Prosatanis
needs. So of course, who shows up? Prosatanis.
Again, another creepy moment, though. Like, they were doing okay still.
Well, like, there's a younger priest, and he's like, man, I shouldn't have eaten at Taco Bell at the train station. I got to take a shit. So he takes off to the bathroom, which leaves the old elderly priest with the piece.
Yeah, he's like, hey, lock the door just in case.
And light a match.
Yeah, light a match. That's bad. You've been reeking it up our little private boxcar all day.
So Prosatan shows up. He just kills the priest, takes the piece.
Yeah, he gives him a nice little monologue there, but it's not worth
it. I will kill you in the name of Satan.
It's going to be so great when I release Satan in like a couple days here.
Back to the cop station. We get a nice little, if you're like my age, you'll get the H. Ross Perot joke, the Jackson, very topical joke at the time. Nobody knows who the fuck H. Ross Perot is anymore. He ran against Clinton and George Bush.
I didn't catch the joke, but I know.
Jackson was reading about. He's like, he's going to run again in 96.
Yeah. Okay, that's what I thought.
It's very, so they're very of the time, like the finger on the pulse.
Yeah, for real.
And then once again, more fucking bull talk. He's like, hey, man, did you get me those tickets?
You see how much fans they are? They had like the back dressing. They had Jordan doing a dunk thing. And they had
well, this,
like,
it's just to let you know we're in Chicago, because you would not know that if you didn't see all this fucking bullshit everywhere.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, even Chuck's wearing a fucking Bull starter jacket. That's how crazy it is.
When he's not wearing the blazer, he's wearing the starter jacket.
And the breakaway pants, like the sweats, you know? He's like, I got good news and bad news. He's like, all right, well, give me the bad news.
Give me that bad news first.
And he's like, I got you your tickets to game 3.
He starts freaking out, not even totally oblivious to the fact that he picked the bad news. Oh, what's the good news then?
We got to go to Israel. 3 hours. And he goes, oh, hell no.
Jesus Christ.
So then we got. So
he's like, you picked me out personally. Like, you didn't even try to take someone else. So he's like, no, I don't know what you're talking about. Like,
and this, well, this scene makes no sense, because it's like, all right, because an Israeli rabbi had been murdered. So that's why. So as far as I know, 93, we had telephones. So I don't know why they had to fly. Also, they know nothing about the case. All they know is they found a dead body of this guy and the guy that probably killed him. That's all they know. They know nothing about, you know, what they've learned later about the Prosatan and stuff. But
yeah.
So they're like, but they have to go to Israel. They have to fly to fucking Israel for this. So the boss is like, you guys better dress properly. This is the international thing. You want to make us look good.
Yeah.
And they're like, got it, boss.
That's what the cop told them as they were getting out. Like, you're meeting the police chief today. You need to dress well. I don't think they didn't talk to that commissioner anymore, I didn't think.
I don't know.
Either way.
So they fly to Israel. They get off the bus. Some jokes about how shitty the fucking flight was.
Yeah.
I'm surprised he didn't say about the food was awful. So,
yeah, some Seinfeld-level jokes. What's the deal with the flight to Israel? You know why they did the rest of this in Israel? Is because they did the whole film in Israel. So they probably ran out of the like Chicago-looking street set. So they were just like, fuck, what do we do now? Let's just go to Israel.
And then I want to point out an error. This, you can tell this is written by a white guy who's writing black guy dialogue.
Oh, boy.
Jackson's always hot. Black people are never fucking hot. They're always cold. But he's always bitching about how hot everything is.
All the time. And, of course, they're there in their starter jackets because it's fucking playoff season.
Yeah, right.
So,
you got to show your colors.
He's sweating. Where do you keep getting these toys from, you asshole? So despite sweating through, you know, his starter jacket, he's leaving it on, and they're going through this hilarious trip through town. And there's this.
Bear in mind, we thought this was a horror movie. That's why we picked this movie.
And I wanted to get the music they played, because once they get to Israel, this is 30 minutes into the movie, 40 minutes of the podcast. Great case. they're constantly with the antics. It's just jokes everywhere.
And the music, it's almost like Benny Hill music.
Yeah,
it's all like crazy.
Plate spinning. Can't say that for some reason. It's ridiculous. And so,
we get a great line where the Jackson and Frank are in the back of his taxi, and then Jackson says something's like shitty, and then the guy goes, ah, shitty. What does that mean?
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, man, it means like, you know,
the
like
best,
the best, like a Top Gun.
Top Gun.
Top Gun. I've seen that movie.
Yeah.
Man, I'm a shitty driver.
Top Gun shout
see,
out.
He doesn't get that shitty means shitty.
Mm-hmm.
So he thinks shitty means good. That's the joke.
So he drives crazily. They get in there. You know, Jackson's freaking out. Chuck's stoic.
He says, oh, hell no, like 3 times.
Yeah. So they arrive at the hotel. Jackson lets out another, oh, hell no, I'm not sleeping here. It's just like a hole in the wall.
He's like, I got to have some AC, man. Fuck this heat. Yeah.
So we get to see their nice little room there, and of course he mentions again, like, I got to sleep in this bed. I need that AC. And Chuck's like, why do you, why? And he's like, well, I snore really loudly if I'm hot. Yeah. Is that a reason?
No, that doesn't happen.
So they're getting ready to go meet the police
chief. They're getting dressed up because they're going to meet the police chief. Yeah.
And by dress up, Jackson, by the way, is wearing like slacks and a nice button-up shirt. So it's like, okay, he's ready. But Chuck's putting on like a Tommy Bahama, like, dad on vacation shirt.
What's wrong with that? That's pretty funny. puts on his Timberlands.
He puts on his beige Timberlands. And, you know, he's got his rock-washed, acid-washed blue jeans.
He does, yeah.
And he's like, I'm looking good. Let's go meet.
All he needed was a bolo tie. I don't know why I didn't have that. But.
Throws on a blazer because you got to top that classic look off.
I think he even pushes it up like old Miami Vice style. Pushes the sleeves up. And so they meet. And then, so this is how great Hellbound is. We don't get just one scene of a police chief chewing someone out. We get two scenes of two separate. We get the Israeli and the woman.
And the commission's just immediately like, hey, guys, let's brief this. It's going to take 9 hours, and Jackson,
hell no.
Man.
And it's like, why is it going to take 8 hours? They barely know anything about this case.
So we get the first ever montage of just document explanation, and Chuck not reacting, and Jackson just like flopping around in his seat. When finally Chuck, it ends, and he notices something, he's like, this isn't the first case you've had. Like this is a reoccurring thing, isn't it? Right. Like, maybe eight other times, nine other times? And he's just like, just remember one thing around here. You know police. Why did I do that?
I don't know. That's your interpretation of Israeli accent.
Apparently.
At least you didn't go Chicago. Which is shocking, because we're in a movie and it's in Chicago, and we haven't had any Chicago accent.
Wow.
Yet.
Hydra Phil didn't even show up for this.
Yeah, damn.
Wow.
Fuck that guy.
Yeah, exactly. Never mind. So they're immediately like, you heard what the commissioner said. We can't fuck around as police here. And Chuck's like, yeah, but we're gonna. So let's go meet up with that Krieger guy, because he was in Israel too.
Yeah, because Krieger was the name that was on the back of that card. So
yeah.
And he was, obviously, if you've been paying attention, we haven't, he was the middleman at where Prostatanus killed the rabbi.
So they're just like, okay, let's go check out this address. We know where he's at. They walk in. He's got, like, you know, his nice antique shop and everything. And I believe they hit him with some bad cop. They just start fucking pushing this. They broke into his house.
Well, yeah, because Jackson's pissed. He's always has to play good cop. Yeah. So he's like, I want to be bad cop.
That's probably the best, like, character building they do in this movie, is Jackson gets fed up and is like, I'm going to be bad cop. So they get mixed up, bad cop. But it works pretty well. They start getting some information out of him. I don't remember what information they got out of him.
I don't either.
And
the fact
that you're looking at me just like, oh, shit, I don't know.
I don't know, but I know it's helpful. And then so they go back to their car, and this is where they just have it out. Because, man, fucking Frank, I mean, we love Chuck, but he's really, like you were saying, he's lording it over Jackson. Like, he's not even, like, giving the guy money for food. He's like, you got to beg me. For food. Jackson hasn't eaten since the day before on the fucking plane.
Yeah. And they don't serve a lot of food on the, I mean, what's the deal with this airplane food?
Yeah, it's just like he's like, all I had was a matzo ball soup.
Yeah.
I'm fucking hungry, man.
Couple peanuts and a pretzel.
And he's like, beg me, dance.
Yeah.
Almost.
Chuck is a fucking freak.
And then he's like, all right, I'll relent. And he gives them like $50 or something.
Yeah.
Whatever his per diem.
I like
was.
That they're carrying all the money that they brought with them. In their pocket, like, they didn't stash that anywhere. They're carrying $1,000 in their pocket, just running around Israel.
Well, yeah, and that also is a bad idea, because as we learn, we see this little kid, little lovable street urchin.
Yeah.
And he leaps into their car.
Yeah.
And, and then he's like, oh, hell no!
And the kid is just like, please, help me. They're coming. The matzo ball. Jesus Christ. What's his name? Merrill is coming to get me, and he's going to beat my ass because he wants something.
He wants money from me. He's a bully.
So you know, Jax is like, no, I'm going to stop this. And, of course, Matsu Joe or whatever I call him shows up and he's separating the kids. Come on. I'm
yeah, so it's like another little kid a couple years older and they start fighting and he's like, oh, hell no, break this up. And he breaks it up. But, of course, Chuck, the fucking genius he is, he knows all what's going on,
yeah,
for real.
Again, just cold, dead stare. He's got a little smirk on his face. He's like, this is fun. You just robbed us of half of our money, the only money we have here, apparently. But yeah, this is funny.
Yeah, because what happens is the little kid who we thought was being bullied is a pickpocket. Yeah. He steals Jackson's wallet.
This is Chuck lording his superiorness over Jackson. He's just...
Right.
Jackson turns to him and is like, you see, man? All you got to do is get him on an equal field, tell him to meet halfway, boom, friendship. Because the kids leave, like, holding hands and skipping.
Right.
And then Chuck's like, oh, that's pretty great. Meet halfway, huh? Why don't you check your pocket? And then you get another, oh, hell no. And he's like, that kid snaked me. And so they have to fucking find these kids now.
And then the Benny Hill music kicks in. And they chase the kid, and they find, of course, Chuck finds the kid.
Because he's just name-chanting it up, just ninth warrior.
He does have kind of a baby Nang-chan on this movie. Because Chuck usually never had a mullet, but
I think he would be a screaming eagle, if anything.
Yeah, it was, well, yeah, maybe
he's
a hybrid.
He's got that patriotism boner.
Yeah. So he finds the kid, because the kid's hiding by hanging off the side of a building.
The AARP of screaming eagles.
And then I love how Chuck's like basically threatening, like, I'll let you die. I'll step on your fingers.
The kid's hanging from four stories up, and Chuck's just like, how long can you hang there? Starts stepping on his fingers, like, do you need a hand? Maybe you can give me the wallet back. And the kid's like, it's in my pocket. He's like, okay. I don't want to pull it out of your bloody little corpse.
He doesn't get any info right now. But the kid, like, earns his, like, the kid respects him now. Because he's like... And this is what I love. Was this supposed to be an insult? Because he's like, oh, so you do this a lot, do you? It only works on Americans. So basically, are we supposed to be assholes because we actually want to help a kid who's in trouble?
Yeah.
Like, what? How is that an insult to us? It's kind of like dumb Americans
helping
a child in danger.
The kid did, because they were lost. This is how they ended up there. They were lost. Jackson didn't want to drive straight anymore, so he had to turn them all over the place. So the kid tells him where Jerusalem University
is. Oh, good old Jerusalem U. Fighting Matzen Balls. Love them.
Chew you.
No, I didn't go that far. And so, yeah, so they knew they needed to go to Jerusalem University. They didn't know where it was.
Exactly.
So
the kid gave him the directions.
Because this place was like a swap meet. Or as Chuck said, they call it a flea market.
Which
I don't think they call a flea market in Israel.
I mean, we have flea markets.
Yeah. They call it probably a bazaar or something like that, you know.
That would have been the better way to go with it. Yeah. But, yeah.
Well,
so
we're dealing with Chuck. Chuck thinks he knows everything.
Exactly. He's everything. He's the worst. He is the worst.
Well, he's dosed to go. Come on. I mean.
It's true.
So they go up to old Jerusalem U, and look who's there. It's our friend.
Miss Hawkins. And, you know.
She's like, hey, funny meeting you here.
Funny running into you here. And Chuck's just like got the, you know, stars in his eyes again.
You know what happened was?
Ooh.
What happened? We're going back to the shadows.
Are we?
When they were good cop, bad cop, and Krieger, they found out that Professor Lockley was at Jerusalem U. That's what they got from Krieger.
Yeah.
So they're like, hey, we need to talk to Professor Lockley. She's like, oh, he's at this excavation site. I'll take you to him.
Yeah, so nice little drive over there. We see a man on the hill.
Right, like a silhouette.
And we're supposed to care about this man because they zoom in on him nine times.
You see like this wispy hair floating
in the
breeze.
Yeah, he's got a big blue, big bushy beard.
Yeah. That was the blind side, like the fake out.
Yeah.
And then we learn that, holy fucking shit, people. Professor Lockley is pro Satanas.
Ooh, no. But he
does the Superman move where, you know, Superman would just put glasses on and you wouldn't tell Superman. He has eyebrows. So keep in mind, Chuck had a life or death battle with this guy yesterday.
Yeah.
And he doesn't recognize him at all.
It was so dark. And, you know, it was just, everybody was kung fu fighting. And
those cats are fast as lightning.
He was fast as lightning. Yeah, he doesn't recognize, he's supposed to be the fucking greatest cop in the world.
Yeah, really.
And he doesn't recognize this man?
Well, he's not using this voice. He's using a British voice.
Yeah, much more Christopher civilized. Christopher
Lee-like. Like, what are you doing here? He's like, princess, which will come into play later. He always calls Hawkins princess.
Yeah, you know, that made sense when I watched it the second time. I was like, oh shit, there's layer. One layer. That's
it. He's like, who are these people? And they're like, we have this scepter piece. Can you examine it? He's like, this is obviously a fake.
Yeah, and they're like, well, we found these paintings and drawings all over the place of it, so we think it. And he's like, you've probably seen paintings and drawings of Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny, but are you dumb enough to believe in them? And of course he looks over at Jackson, and Jackson's like nodding. God, why do they fucking stick it to Jackson all the time?
Because they have to make Chuck look good.
Yeah, but, fucking Chuck, I hate him. So he fucking Protanus, Lockley, whatever his name is, he scoffs at them. He's like, princess,
harumph.
And he shoos himself off, but he
toss kinda, some salad and scramble.
I gotta go scramble and toss salad. And he scurries off, but he stays within earshot where he hears, like, you know, a princess dogging him. He's like, well, I said he is pretty eccentric. And where do we go?
So they got a dead end. So they go back to the hotel. I also want to point out, even though we thought it was going to be integral to the plot, but it's not. There's a mysterious Jesus-like figure who's always lurking, like watching everywhere. Chuck. He does nothing, so you can forget about him, but he's there. Just remember, he's there. He looks like Jesus, and he really stands out. Like, he's literally wearing, like, the robes like Jesus. It's not like just a guy with a beard.
Oh, yeah. Full-on white.
And so they go back to the hotel, and, like,
they really made sure to set the scene up, too, because they come back to the hotel like four times prior to this, and they always ask the guy, the clerk, any messages for us? And he always, So this time they show up.
Right, and he's like, well, yeah, it's your boss. She wants to hear from you ASAP.
Yeah.
And Chuck's like, pulling fucking rank again. He's like,
exactly.
He's like, you talk to her. And he's like, what? What do I got to talk to her? He's like, I'm a sergeant and you ain't.
Yeah.
I'm going to go get out of my Tims and relax.
Go take the Tims off.
Relax in front of the AC.
You know why he wore those Tims? He needed to feel taller.
Probably. So he goes back to the room. Because, man, this is why story-wise, we needed it. Because there's some, like, Taliban guys hiding in the room.
Yep.
And so we get back and forth. Chuck's like, old man ass kicking. It's like, if you watch on Laserdisc like I did, you know I have this huge Laserdisc library. You can actually see the invisible wires picking up Chuck's legs, because he can barely get his legs up.
He can't get those legs up anymore, man. He's 70 at the time.
So there's like a comedic like fight. Meanwhile, Jackson's talking to the police chief, and he's like talking about, oh yeah, man, he's been thinking about you and all. She's like, really?
Yeah. Ooh. Like, oh, I got a glimpse of his journal he keeps, and man, he's just like talking about how much better this place would be with you, and he's picking out restaurants he thinks he would like. He found a vintage wine that he says would pair well with your eyes. And so laying it on thick.
And she's like, do whatever you want.
Yeah.
Stay as long as you need.
Oh, make sure he calls me soon, because I can't wait to talk to him. So he hangs up the phone, and he's feeling all good. He's like, I fucking stuck it to Chuck. Feeling good about myself. But he immediately gets attacked from behind before he gets to open the door. And he has the scepter in his pocket. Right. So
they steal it.
So that gets stolen. He gets up, walks into the room, and fucking Chuck is, I got to go turn that off.
Is that your AC going off right now?
Yeah.
Because it's hot as shit in here.
Well, maybe take the starter jacket off.
Oh, hell no.
So
I actually did have a sweet Buffalo Bill starter jacket.
I know you did.
And then some fuckers fucking jumped me and ripped it. That's the worst part of it.
You had it? That happened, what, like 8 years ago?
Yeah, I had it that long. I had it since high school. It was pristine.
Wow.
It's probably worth a shitload of money if it was actually in shape.
That was the, you know, you were asking me about the trends earlier in Brooklyn. Fucking starter jackets, dude.
Motherfuckers.
Yeah. You would have been hot to trot.
Back to the movie. So
this is where Chuck tell you know Farouk Jackson comes in the room. He's like, "Hey man, what the fuck happened in here? They got the scepter too." And he immediately knows that Krieger.
Well, they knew something was up with Krieger. So they assumed he probably stole it back. So they go back to Krieger.
And
before that happens, our boy Prosatanis shows up.
He beats us too, Krieger.
And he beats the shit out of Krieger, Freddy Krieger. And he throws him on. There's like some kind of African art thing on the wall. There's a horn. He throws Krieger onto the horn, kills him. And then I guess Krieger had the piece because he takes the piece, Prosatanis.
Yeah, they mentioned that it's a fake and everything. But for some reason...
I think Prosatanis wanted him to think it was worthless so then he could get it back.
The one that... I guess. I don't know.
I didn't care enough to...
That was a fake. It literally was a fake. That was a fake.
Who had the real one? I don't even remember. Did Krieger have it?
The blind guy.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah, the blind guy at the end had it. I don't know why... I think he just wanted to end the people who knew him. Krieger knew too much, so he just...
Why not? So then he kills him, and then Jackson and Shatter show up, and they find Krieger dead, and...
I believe this is when Chuck notices a picture. Did Krieger have the picture of Hawkins, or is that later on?
Well, you know what we're missing? I guess it's not integral to the part because I totally forgot about it. Remember when they break back into the police station and they get... Does that happen later?
That's going to happen now.
Okay.
Wow. You see, you stumbled right on it. You're like Chuck finding clues. You're just I don't know what to do. So maybe,
Power of the starter jacket.
Mm. I wanted you to swish that around for us a little bit. That's what I hated about those fucking jackets.
Mine couldn't do that.
Why not? No,
I don't know. I just didn't. It didn't have the thing.
All of them had that texture to them, that rainproof texture, I thought.
Oh, I thought you were saying it was like you could turn it inside out and wear it like a...
No, I meant just like the exterior.
It was a great jacket. I missed that jacket.
I'm sorry you lost it.
Yeah, sorry. So am I.
So... I forget what clue they find there, but they're like, we got to...
They find a scroll.
The scroll. And yes,
and
that's
it's like
right.
a check mark. It's like a it's a grocery list.
It is a grocery list of scepter pieces with each piece written where it is.
Yeah, and which rabbi had them.
And of course, they're like, oh shit, is that a place or a name? I'm not going to say another horrible thing. So they're like, we got to get down to that police station. And they bust in there.
Yeah.
And Jack's like, oh, hell no, I'm not busting in this cop shop, as he calls it.
Yeah. And apparently, there's so little crime in Jerusalem that everybody goes home at the end of the day at the police station.
One guy's there. Yeah. And of course, he notices Jackson stealing, and Chuck swoops in.
Yeah, way to profile.
Yeah. Chuck gives him the sleeper hold.
Puts him in the sleeper hold.
4 seconds long. God damn, that's so...
And then it just puts him out. Like, I just want to point out, you can't... I mean, a sleeper hold's a real thing, but as soon as you're, out, the blood flows back to your head, and you're up in a few seconds. But, of course, in the movie, you're out for, 10 minutes with a sleeper hold. So, he takes him out. And they're like, hey, look at these names. They line up, these murders, because they get that file that the police chief didn't want them to see.
Yep.
And, thankfully, it's all written in English, even though we're in Israel. And they're like, hey, wait, these names on the scroll line up. And then Chuck gets an idea. He's like, hold on, let me call Hawkins. He calls her up. He's like, hey, do you happen to have the log of all the talks that Professor Lockley had, where he'd been, what days? She's like, sure, I got it right here. And then they're like, holy shit, they line up. Every time there was a murder, Dr. Lockley, a.k.a. Prosatanis, was in town.
Yeah.
So Chuck puts it all together. He's like, holy shit.
Yeah. So the one, we did miss one thing, and that was them going to that castle where they meet Farouk's underling, where we find out that, that's where the...
Oh, you're right. I got confused.
No, it's okay.
Okay, yeah, right. So
they meet the guy who's got the real scepter head.
Farouk is the Jesus guy that we've been talking about. Yeah. That plays no part in this movie.
Exactly.
At all.
They just do zoom-ins on him, and that's it. Right. So they find out about the scepter head.
They meet up the little kid again who's ripping off another American.
Another American.
A scumbag American who's trying to help a kid.
Yep.
And then you notice, too, that Jackson learned his lesson because he's wearing a fanny pack after he got his wallet stolen.
Yeah, with a little lock on it. Just in case.
And so he's like, I can take you there. Because Chuck likes to like, give the guys money back and I'll let you slide.
Right.
And then you can tell it's where Farouk is.
Yeah. He's like, it's a place. It's right over
there.
Because
Farouk is the last name on the scroll.
Yeah.
So they go to this like temple and they find this blind guy who's not Farouk. He's just like a follower of Farouk. Yeah. And he's like, get out of here.
Yeah. It's the key to the gates of hell. He's blind as fuck, and of course, like, he goes, after he talks to them, he immediately goes to make sure the scepter's still there.
Right.
He pulls it out, fucking Prosentanis.
Chuck
and Jackson leave, so they're, like, sitting out in the car, they left the kid in there, and they didn't crack the windows, it's 155 degrees, right. So what a great parental guidance, you know, Chuck is. So they get outside, and fucking Prosentanis is there. To get his scepter, and he fucking murders the blind guy.
Right.
Chuck.
He didn't see it coming.
Yeah.
That's the kind of humor we're talking about in this movie.
That's a nice 3-point swish right there. So
he didn't see it coming. That's how Chuck would say
there you
it.
Go. That felt good. That felt very Chuck-like. So that's where we get into the cop station.
Yeah, so they hear the, oh, kind of like Anton Maiden earlier in the song. Like, ah!
Six.
So they run back in, and they're like, oh, snap.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, hell no. They just killed the blind guy.
So that's where they end up in the police station. That's where we get the sleeper hold. That's where we get Hawk. You know, they're going to give a call to Hawkins.
Yeah, okay. And then, but then they got to, why do they go to Hawkins' place? They go to Hawkins' place. This is where they find the picture.
Well, that they find out he needs royal blood.
Right.
And then he gets Hawkins on the phone. He ends up getting somebody else who's like, oh, no, she's not home. So they, like, go to her house.
You're right. Yes. Okay, yeah.
And they want to check up on her for whatever reason. Maybe just to talk. Chuck's finally ready to bone. So they show up at her house, and they notice the picture of her and her family. And he's like, this motherfucker's a duke. That's royalty.
Yeah, because they're, like, wearing crowns and shit.
Yeah. And he also notices the mountain of Royal Crown cola cans just scattered everywhere.
Ugh, he's the worst cola.
Putting two and two together here.
She deserves it. Yeah, she's heir to the Royal Crown cola thing. That's like royalty in America.
Yeah, for sure.
So they're like, shit, we got to go to the excavation site. Yep. So this is where all hell breaks loose, as Chuck would say. Because they show up. Prosentanis has got her tied down on that altar then from the beginning of the movie. Yeah. And he's getting ready to kill her. He's got his voice. His voice is back.
Greasing up her hair. Getting her all ready.
And he's doing like the pronouncement. He's getting ready to stab her. He's got his little minions all around him. Chuck's like, oh, hell no.
Yeah.
And he walks in and just starts karate chopping everybody. All the minions.
So this is a pretty long fight. Like, this is more action than we saw in all of the hour and a half of Against the Dark in this 10 minutes. Yeah. And, yeah.
When Chuck needs help, he's still, if you watch the laser disc, you can see all the wire work. He's, like, basically a marionette. They're just, like, positioning him around. He's, like, kicking the shit out of everybody.
I watched some of the DVD extras, and there was a couple where they had him, like, in the crane where they just swoosh him around like he was flying. It's like a child playing with dolls.
It's like a production of Peter Pan, basically.
Oh, my God. Chuck's the worst. So so I did keep track. Who are these acolytes, by the way? Like,
they just showed up.
They were
waiting for this to happen.
Yeah, like, he never had, Prosentanis never has, like, buds or, like, people that follow him. But in this scene, he's got 45 friends that Chuck and his partner have to beat the shit out of now.
Right.
So, of course, they do that. You know, they have, like, a 5-round fight with Prosentanis.
Yeah, it's like, it keeps, it's like this most annoying fight, because Chuck will kick him in the face, and then he'll disappear.
Yeah.
And then they'll talk with Hawkins a little bit. She'll give him a little exposition, you know. You have to stab him with the scepter.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, Prosentanis jumps up again, and then they fight him a little more, and then he disappears for some reason.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of, like, fake outs.
So there, I went ahead and kept track because I like to give people some numbers. Really, people like to chew on numbers. And so I took track. Chuck kicks below the waist. So he did maybe, like, I got about 30 kicks on record here. 18 of those kicks below the waist. And the old adage is that Chuck can't kick above the waist. So he's either
people. Well, at this time in his life, he could probably back in the day.
Back in the day, maybe in his early 20s he could, but I think by 25 he was already a mess. So anyways, below the waist, 18 kicks. A lot of times you see bad guys who would fall over and then he would kick them in the face. There were right. six of those. And then actual high kicks where they
he's did literally kicking somebody while they're down.
Where you saw the marionette wire work going on, seven right. of them. Okay.
How many roundhouses? He did a couple at least.
There was four.
Okay.
And only one of them was actually with a person standing. For the most part, they were kneeled over.
Okay. So he takes care of the minions. Then there's this cat and mouse game where like he kicks Prosotanis, he disappears, comes back, disappears, comes back. I mean, in between, they're getting more exposition from Hawkins. She's yeah. telling him, and then she tells him the golden rule.
Yeah, you the got, scepter.
Scepter, which once again, what? It's the source of his power, yet it kills him, too?
Yeah.
I don't know what the fuck's
it's
going
the
on.
It's the weirdest relationship he has with this scepter. Yeah, but that, of course... the mention
it sounds like something that would be in a video game though like to,
again it
like,
does
you would like
yeah
put it together and then it would be the thing the only thing that could kill the big boss.
So like a gun in every other movie, the mention of the scepter finally snaps Prosotanis. He knows about this rule, but Chuck and Jackson don't know. But Hawkins mentions it, and then they're, you know, it's a mad scramble for it because it's on the ground like 10 feet away from them, and so right. Jackson course gets stepped on,
the real hero of the movie,
but it trips up Prosotanis, so Chuck can go in. He grabs the fucking scepter and just fucking Nolan Ryan expresses it right through Prosotanis's gut, and that's where we get some Spark Factory shit happening.
No.
Turns into a lizard person.
Yeah, that was which we learned in our gore episode. Or did we? Lizard people are our friends. We've always thought they weren't. I'll get more into. I revealed on our gore episode that I'm QAnon, and I told people it's the truth about the deep state on this episode. That's why the episode has over 100 downloads.
Yes,
but when we do the sequel, Outlaw of Gore, I will go more into depth
Holy
about lizard
shit.
People. But that's down the road. We got so much great shit planned. But that's down the road. But anyway, so yes, he's a lizard person. Very, I didn't like it. I found it offensive because lizard people are our friends, like I'm going to tell you in the future episode.
And
but,
they're no squeak box for Satan. I mean, come on.
Right. But for sake of the movie, yeah, they're villains. And does he explode? I don't even remember.
He explodes.
Okay, good.
Sparks up, explodes, and then Farouk shows up. All the scepter pieces are scattered into nine once more. So he's going to go out, spread the seeds, you know, for so the next
yeah,
game.
Yeah, that's the only reason for Farouk, the Jesus-looking guy, is to go, I guess, well, I'll just start the video game all over again.
Exactly. We'll give it to the next person. They can have a fresh try. Game over. Shows the high scores. Chuck's got 4 billion. Jackson's got like 12.
Chuck puts his initials.
Yep.
F.S. I don't know what his middle name is. F. The Frank fucking Shatters, like F.F.S.
F.F.S.
And then speaking of game over.
Oh, shit. Was that
hell no.
Oh, hell no.
We cut to the airport. They're ready to leave. Fucking Jackson, he's preoccupied. It's the final game of the fucking NBA Finals. He's watching. He's like, yay, we won!
Of course they're playing the NBA Finals in
an Israeli airport. Yeah, and it's on like some tiny-ass fucking TV hanging on the wall. So he's happy. Chuck's happy because him and Hawkins are like sparks, more spark, pun intended, sparks are flying with them too.
Yeah.
And he's like, maybe I could.
I haven't seen sparks like this since yesterday when we fucking blew up that lizard person.
Yeah. And he's like, maybe I could buy you coffee sometime. I don't know what he said.
Yeah. Maybe I could read you a dictionary.
It was very chaste. Yeah. But, and she's like, hey, I would like that.
They're pretty much the same on Walker, Texas Ranger as well. And the other thing is. He has a very he has a black partner on Walker, Texas Ranger, but the partner actually has dignity and actually Chuck respects him and deserves it.
Hey,
like,
wait.
The character.
We didn't talk about it, but there's a point in this movie where he goes, Chuck says it. He's like, if I didn't respect you, you wouldn't be my partner. Because he says, you don't respect me.
Oh.
That's when they're in the car right before they get robbed. And he's like, because... As we all know, most great cops are lone wolves. They don't use. They don't work with partners. Even though it's part of your job, and you do what your boss tells you. Except in movies where he's like, "I work alone," but he doesn't because he respects Jackson.
Right.
Just in that weird kind of way. It's that kind of like tough love.
Well, they appreciate the job and the work, and that mutual respect for the work, and They like how they conduct. They're a dynamic duo. The good cop, bad cop. They're great.
They're the best of the good cop.
So
the bad cop.
To close it out, we get a nice scene of the kid robbing Jackson once more. And then
one more. Oh hell yeah! Oh hell no! He says oh hell yeah when the Bulls went, and then he says oh hell no when he snakes his wallet again.
And then bam.
I thought he learned his lesson with the fucking fanny pack, but he didn't.
Straight to credits.
And then straight freeze frame. Everyone's like yay!
Yeah.
And then credits roll, and that ends Canon Films.
That ended Canon Films.
Ends our episode. Ends Canon Films.
All right, man.
So. Are you excited, Griff? This is it. This is where all the marbles.
Yeah.
Next week, it's motherfucking Halloween.
Halloween. Are we going to release this Wednesday, or do you want...
No, we're releasing this Devil's Night.
You want to...
So everyone can enjoy it. Normally, technically, we release them Wednesday night. You've listened to us. We know we don't fucking edit for shit.
They get released late in the night. We should be able to get this
one out earlier. Technically, it's kind of... I guess most of you, if you do, like, right away, you listen to it on Thursday. So we say Thursday, but... We're going to do it because we're Detroit and we love our Devil's Night. We're going to release this on Devil's Night. And you can enjoy it at work, whatever you want to do on Halloween, because it's a Halloween special episode. And this is the perfect movie. We're going to bring our buddy Mike. He's coming back one last time.
At least one last time for Halloween week.
Yes. Well, he's always, all of our friends are always welcome.
Yeah.
But, yeah, he's going to be, because this is the movie he enjoys, I enjoy. I think you're going to enjoy.
I've already seen it.
This
saw it last
is.
Year.
Okay, we had to kill the drama. Okay,
that's my
this
job.
Is probably
that's my job.
That's perfect. This is I put this it's definitely in my top 20. It might be my top 10 favorite horror movies of all time.
God damn. Okay.
And this is a Golan-Globus production.
Ooh, that's 2 weeks in a row, guys.
And we're gonna have one the following week, but we're gonna hold off on that because it's very special. So I'm just gonna cut the chase. We're doing
cut to that chase.
Texas Chainsaw Massacre Part 2.
The best part.
Yes.
Two part.
The sequel lives up. It's not as terrifying as the original, but it has some great characters in it.
Yeah.
I genuinely love it. I'm not being ironic about this. I love this movie. I think you will love it. So I hope we can see you then on Halloween.
Yeah.
So till then, keep it warm.
Yep.
White man came across the sea. He brought us pain and misery. He killed our tribe, he killed our greed. He took our game for his own need. We fought him hard, we fought him well. Out on the plain, we gave him hell. But many came, too much for greed. Oh, will we ever be set free? Driving through dust clouds and barren waste, galloping hard on the plains, chasing the redskins back to their holes, fighting them at their own game. Murder for freedom, the stab in the back, women and children and cowards attack. Run to